It is great to have you with us this morning, this special Good Friday service, Reflections on the Cross. It's great to have so many folk with us. If we haven't met, my name's Gary, and I'm part of the chaplaincy team here at Woolaware Shores. It's our pleasure to have you with us on this Good Friday. We come together on Good Friday to celebrate really what is the central point of history. We come together to reflect on what is at the very heart of what it means to be a Christian, at the heart of the Christian faith, the death of our Lord Jesus on the cross. Many people will say that over these last couple of years, things like coronavirus have changed our lives. Things will never quite be the same again. And at one level, that may well be true. But the events of the first Easter, they did not change a lifetime. They changed eternity. And our service today will highlight that although the death of the Lord Jesus was, at one level, the worst possible display of human sinfulness, the death of an innocent man, a perfect man, at the other end of the spectrum, it displays God's perfect, boundless, endless grace that he would step into our world. He would deal with our sin so that we might be saved by him. This morning, Paul is going to open for us four cries that Jesus makes from the cross that talk about the depth of God's love and talk about the completeness of his salvation. As the Apostle Paul said when he wrote to the church at Corinth, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That great transfer. Friends, how about I pray as we begin our time? Our gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for giving your Son to die on the cross so that we might be forgiven. As we meet this morning, help us to understand the extent of our sin. Help us to understand the greatness of your love so that we might trust in him as our Saviour, and we might serve him as our Lord. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Friends, today all that we will need to do will be up on the screens in front of us, so you don't need an order of service. Our first hymn is going to reflect for us the amazing love that unfolds in the midst of the events of that first Good Friday. So if you're confident and if you're safe to stand, please stand with us as we sing Amazing Love.
Oh,
take a seat. Our first Bible reading this morning is Jesus, a cry of forgiveness. And in the way our service works this morning, after each reading, Paul will bring us a reflection, and then there will be an opportunity for us to respond in some way. So after Paul's reflection, after our first reading, Margaret is going to come and lead us in a time of prayer. So Jan, thank you for coming and reading for us our first reading.
Luke chapter 23, beginning at verse 32. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise."
Thank you, Jan. Well, good morning, everyone. It's great to see all of you here. Thank you for encouraging us this morning with your presence. And isn't it just wonderful the sun is out on Good Friday? I think we're expecting rain and one of those miserable wet Easters, so it's wonderful to have that here. The sun, that is. Let me begin by just mentioning bullfighting. I don't know about you, but in my opinion, bullfighting is just a cruel, cruel sport. It's an exercise in ritual humiliation and slaughter. A bull is led into the arena and is deliberately baited into attacking the matador. First, an assistant on a horse stabs the animal in the neck muscles with a lance. Then three other assistants come into the arena and attempt to place two barbed sticks called banderillas into each of the bull's shoulders. All of this weakens and enrages the bull. Finally, the matador enters the arena with his famous cape and provokes the bull to charge at him so that he can stab him to death with a sword, and 95% of the time, the bull dies. It's a popular sport in some countries, considered an art form. I find it hard to be so sympathetic. From my point of view, the aim is to tease and provoke an animal until it snaps with rage, thus providing a spectacle until it is ritually slaughtered. But what is called an art form in bulls is called, ironically enough, bullying in humans. That's what you call it when you tease, mock, provoke, and humiliate someone until that person snaps in rage. Jesus was ritually humiliated and slaughtered. He was beaten, spat upon, whipped, mocked, and humiliated before suffering a ritualized execution. The apex of his mocking came when the Roman soldiers dressed him in royal robes and jammed a crown of thorns on his head and bowed before him in mock honour, shouting, "Hail, King of the Jews!" The climax of his humiliation was when he was made to carry his own cross And when he reached the place of his execution, he was stripped naked, nailed to that cross, and hung for the whole world to see. He should have snapped. He should have told the crowd exactly what it could do with its taunts. But he didn't. Instead, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Upon being asked by one of the criminals to remember him when he came into his kingdom, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Does this amaze you? It sure amazes me. After all he has gone through, at his greatest point of stress, Jesus forgives. In a sea of violence, degradation, and pain, here is this ray of light, forgiveness. It's a sublime picture of forgiveness, in my view, because the criminal did not deserve forgiveness. He was on a cross, after all. He did nothing to impress, persuade, compel, or blackmail Jesus into forgiving him. He simply recognized his own sin. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our sins deserve. And then he asked to join Jesus' side. "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." It's all we need to do. And our lives depend on it. It's the difference between entering Jesus' kingdom and entering the other place. We may not steal, take drugs, or commit some other crime. We may be good members of society. But our actions against God are serious. Our refusal to follow him means we refuse to acknowledge the source, the king of our lives. And that is serious. It's so serious, it's akin to treason. We need God's forgiveness. We need to recognize our own sin, as the thief did, and ask Jesus to rule our lives so we are on his side. Our lives depend on it. I urge you to ask today for that forgiveness.
The prayers this morning, at the end of each prayer I will say the words, "Lord, in your mercy," and if you'd like to reply, "Hear our prayer." Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All praise and honour to you, Lord Jesus, for by your death and resurrection you have shown us the amazing depths of your love, overcome the power of death, and brought joy and hope to a world darkened by sin and despair. O God and Father of all, how deep is your love for mankind that you could send your Son to die a terrible and degrading death, to experience the violence and callousness of wicked men, to be mocked and scorned, dying on a cross, that we might know the forgiveness and a peace which passes all understanding. We stand in the shadow of the cross with those who loved your Son, humbled yet grateful for his sacrifice, in awe of what he took upon himself to free us from the burden of our sins and the power of death. Help us to be agents of peace and love, who work to right the injustices of the world, to speak for those who have no voice, and to bring knowledge of your love and mercy to the oppressed and the downtrodden, And Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Son of God, we celebrate this Easter season with your church, the fellowship of believers around the world. Protect those who serve you in areas of danger or where the gospel is rejected, as you were rejected, Lord, by unbelievers and sceptics. We pray for protection for those who can't openly practice their faith, and that despite their circumstances in this Easter season, you will fill their hearts with quiet joy, hope, and love. At the cross, your work was finished, but ours is just beginning. Help us to find the words to explain the true story of Easter and the courage to speak when opportunities arise. Help us to play our part in ensuring that the gospel goes out to the ends of the earth, that all may share in the true freedom and new life offered by your sacrificial death. And Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Servant King, in the Garden of Gethsemane, you wrestled in anguish at your approaching death. You understand what it is to be challenged physically, spiritually, and emotionally. Bring your healing, Lord, and comfort into the lives of all who need healing in mind, body, or spirit, that they may know the depths of your love and your grace. You loved your own until the end, ministering tenderly to them in word and deed. May we also, who have known your compassion, open our arms in love, offering tenderness and understanding to those whose lives are filled with grief and emptiness. But most of all, empower us to bring the promise of forgiveness and healing that your death has brought to all who will believe. And Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gentle Shepherd, you who were without sin, opened your arms wide upon the cross, allowing the sins of the world to be poured upon you, welcoming and forgiving all who accept your sacrificial death is for them. When our lives come to an end, we pray that as you have promised, you will forgive us all our shortcomings and stretch out your arms to receive us, that we may not fear to surrender into your hands, and with all the saints we may enjoy your blessed presence for eternity. We bring all our prayers on this special day in the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now I think the words of the Lord's Prayer are going to come up onto the screen. No, they're not. Okay. So I invite you to join with me in saying these words now. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And if we could go back to the confession. Thank you. I'm sorry. Talking about our sins and shortcomings may have brought up in us the desire to confess those sins, to bring them before the Lord. And so I would invite you now to join with me in these words of this confession. O Lord our God, you know us better than we know ourselves. As we come before you now, believers and doubters alike, we all share a deep need, for we are all lost without your grace. Search us, O God, and know our hearts. Test us and know our troubled thoughts. Give us true repentance. Forgive us all our wrongs. Transform us by your Spirit to live for you each day, to learn to serve each other, and through the grace of Jesus Christ our Lord, to come at last to heaven. Amen.
Thank you, Margaret, very much. Friends, we're now going to come to our second Bible reading, which Bruce is going to bring to us, which is Jesus' cry of love from the cross. Thank you, Bruce.
Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother, his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, his disciple took her into his home.
Thank you, Bruce. I've noticed something about suffering over the years. When you're going through it, your focus in life can become quite narrow. You are going through pain. It is dominating your life, and other people's problems seem petty and irrelevant. And furthermore, the joys of others can actually sometimes just add to your pain. That's probably the real problem with suffering, I suspect. It can make you incredibly self-absorbed and self-focused. You could understand if Jesus' focus was narrow that day, when you consider all he was going through. And that makes his concern for his mother even more amazing. There really wasn't any compelling reason to be concerned, when you think about it. Jesus had four brothers and several sisters. Mary could have been taken care of by them. We don't know why Jesus entrusted his mother to the care of the Apostle John. But whatever the reason, it appears this is what Jesus considered was the best solution for Mary's needs. This little picture of love is representative of how Jesus loves all of us. Jesus loved his mother by concentrating on providing what was best for her sake, without compulsion. And he loves us in the same way. Jesus was not compelled to die on the cross. When he was arrested, one of his disciples drew his sword to fight. And Jesus responded, "Put your sword back in its place. For all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But then how would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen this way?" That's Matthew chapter 26, verses 52 to 54. No, Jesus did this for our sake, to take away our sins. As the Apostle Peter later put it in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, he himself, that's Jesus, bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. We needed this because our sins are fatal to us. The things we do and say and think, which ignore God, rightly provoke his anger and result in us spending eternity in hell. By dying on the cross and rising again, Jesus saved our lives. Like his actions with his mother, Jesus loves us, concentrating on providing what is best for us, for our sake, without compulsion. We'd be fools, wouldn't we, to reject that love?
Friends, we're going to respond to Jesus' cry of love from the cross by singing together, "Here is Love." Would you stand with us as we sing, please? seat. Our third reading highlights the cost of Jesus' sacrifice when we hear his cry of desolation from the cross. And after our reading from Bruce and Paul's reflection, we're going to watch a little clip called Jerusalem. And you might like to take some time during that clip just to consider your personal response to Jesus on this special Good Friday morning. Thank you, Bruce.
At the sixth hour, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," that which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Years ago, I took a call from a man who was, at that stage, a complete and utter mess. Normally, he wasn't. Normally, he had everything together. Brilliant in his chosen field, he had achieved high rank by the age of 30 and, along with his wife, had paid off his house at the same age. When his work had a particularly nasty or difficult task, it turned to him. He could take just about anything life could throw at him. But on that day, he had reached his tipping point. That point which tips us into the depths of despair. You see, he could take just about anything, but he had just discovered his wife had cancer, and he could not cope with anything happening to his girls, his wife or his daughters. Thankfully, his wife survived. On Good Friday, I think it's fair to say Jesus reached his tipping point, that point of despair, when he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" It's not hard to imagine why, is it? By this stage, he's not merely beaten, he's brutalized. So physically spent that he was made to carry his own cross, but he couldn't do it all the way. He needed help. And at this stage, he's now hanging on that cross, in the blazing Middle Eastern sun. But at midday, or the sixth hour, as verse 33 puts it, things get worse. The land is plunged into darkness. For Jesus, that makes things worse, because he knows what it means. In the Bible, darkness is associated with judgment. There's at least 12 references in the Old Testament to darkness being an expression at times of God's judgment. The physical darkness at this point symbolizes, expresses the judgment Jesus is experiencing as he bears the punishment for all humanity. But that's not all. He's alone. And there's nothing fair about that. When Jesus cries out, he's not merely expressing his anguish. He's actually quoting Psalm 22, verse 1. Now, Psalm 22 is all about a righteous person who suffers unjustly. Jesus is alone, suffering not for his own sin, but for ours. He has no support, no relief, and no comfort from the Father. How can he? The Father is judging humanity, and Jesus, on behalf of humanity, is being judged. Is it any wonder, then, that Jesus reached his tipping point? But I guess for us the question is, how do we respond to this? Do we just ignore it? Move on quickly because, let's face it, this makes us uncomfortable. Personally, I hope it reinforces the authenticity of the story and of Jesus' claims. Because if you were making this up, you would not include a scene where the hero is being degraded and killed in humiliation and anguish. It helps me believe that all of this stuff is true. Hopefully it helps you to come to the same conclusion the centurion made as he was watching Jesus' death. Because we're told in Mark chapter 15, verse 39, that he says, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Hopefully what Jesus has done for you means you will allow him to be the leader of your life.
See me to the land, walking where the
Friends, our final reading today is Jesus' cry of completion. Jesus assures us that God's love and salvation have reached their destination. Thank you, Bruce.
Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
I don't know about you, but I hate cleaning. I realise that makes me sound immature, but look, just hear me out. It's not just that I'd rather do something else far more fun. It's that the job is never finished. If you clean a room and you leave it tidy, and you go away for 6 months, you still need to clean that room when you come back, because dust and decay have grown in the meantime. Cleaning constantly needs to be repeated. I would be much happier to clean something if I knew the job was finished and I would never need to go back to it. On the other hand, what I love about Easter is it is finished. When Jesus said that on the cross, he meant the job's done. It never needs to be repeated. There's no need to come back to it. He has suffered the punishment we all deserve for our sin. All sin has been paid for. Justice has been served. Forgiveness from God has been won. There's no need to ever do this again. So is everything okay now? Perhaps. There is that old saying, isn't there? You can lead a horse to water, but you cannot make it drink. I can lead you to the truth. I can show you how serious sin is. I can show you what Jesus has done for you to save you from the penalty you need to pay for your sin. But I cannot make you accept what Jesus has done for you. That's up to you. But if you want to be saved from the penalty you deserve for sin, you can be. If you want forgiveness for sin, it's on offer. The Apostle Paul tells us what to do in that situation. He says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that he rose from the dead, you are saved. I urge you, if you haven't yet done this, do so. Do it without delay. In a moment, Gary's going to come and introduce our next song, and it's a song that allows us to reflect and survey all that has gone on in life and consider whether we need to commit to Jesus.
Friends, we do this morning want you to consider seriously Jesus' cries from the cross, his cry of forgiveness, his cry of love, his cry of desolation, and reflect on that cry of completion. We want to give you the best opportunity we can to respond to that. So on your seats as you walk in, there was a book called Making the Most of the Rest of Your Life. That is our Easter gift to you, because we know that it has less calories than the other things you're going to receive this Easter. But inside, you will have also found a little reply slip and a pencil. We want to give people the opportunity to respond in a way that allows them to think through the implications of what Jesus has done. Some folk did that decades ago, and they've walked with Jesus all these years. But some of us, sort of, Jesus is out there, but we still have questions. We still don't quite see how it's important or how it all fits together. or the Sunday school Jesus just seems quite pale in our adult world? Well, we want to give you the opportunity to think those implications through, because as Paul said, that offer of forgiveness is on offer for every one of us. So in the next little while at Woolworths Shores, we're going to be offering a thing called Christianity Explored, which is a 7-week course. It will start the day after Anzac Day in the Bombora Room, 3:30 to 5 o'clock on a Tuesday afternoon. Paul will be leading that. And we would invite anyone for whom Jesus is still a bit foggy, still a bit misty, still there are still questions. This is your opportunity to come along in the light of all that we've talked about this morning and see the importance of Jesus. So in a moment, I'm going to encourage you, if that's what you'd like to do, you can tick the box on the slip. You might have just heard something as Paul unpacked those parts of the Bible for us, or as we sang those great songs, or as we saw the song on the screen. That might have triggered you to think about things between you and God, you and Jesus. If that's what you'd like to do, then please tick that second box. I'd like to talk to someone about something I heard today. And now, obviously, if you tick one of those first two boxes, it will make it a lot easier for us if you actually put your name and telephone number there. You know, that'll be really helpful. So if you could do that. But you might just want to make a comment about today's service. You know, great music, excellent teaching. Gary, you need a better haircut. You know, whatever it might be. But we'd love to hear from you. And as we sing our final song, I've got some friends who are going to pass some bags along. This isn't an offertory song. There's an offertory box out the back on a table, if that is how you give. That's absolutely fine. But this, what we want you to do is put your slip and your pencil in that bag as it comes along. So I'm going to give you, Pam's going to play some twinkly music and give you the opportunity to fill in this response slip. Then we'll stand and sing our final song. Thank you, friends. Anybody needs any help, like spelling their name or anything like that? If you see Margaret, she was a primary school deputy principal. She writes very neatly. It's very helpful. It's really good. I'm going to encourage you to finish. We're going to, in a moment, we'll stand and sing our final hymn. I just want to invite everybody to. It's been great to have you with us. And we've had a team of people who've been really helpful, and they've got a whole lot of hot cross buns that they don't want to take home, friends. A lot of hot cross buns that they don't want to take home. Everybody is welcome to stay and join us for morning tea. It will be great to have you with us. We've had a great time together as we've looked at God's word. Let's have a great time together as we share in fellowship. Friends, would you stand, please, as we sing our final hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. And the bags will go around. Remember, just for these. Blessing. But just a reminder that Easter Day, we have two services. 10:30, we'll meet together here for a resurrection celebration with the Lord's Supper. And then at 5 o'clock, we'll have a resurrection celebration in the Bombora Room. Folk are welcome to join us at either service. But just a reminder, if you'd like a lift to the Bombora Room, if you could either be outside your building around 4:30 and Paul will pick you up in Betty's buggy and give you a lift, but that will be helpful for us. So 10:30 and 5 o'clock on Easter Day. It would be great to have you with us. And just a reminder that Monday the 25th of April will be a Village Anzac Day service in the chapel here at 10:30. But let me close with prayer and a benediction. Our Heavenly Father, we see the greatness of your love for us at the cross. We pray that you will fill us with compassion of Christ for the multitudes who do not yet know you. Please give us a vision of the extent of your saving grace and of our opportunity to reach out your saving hand. Stir us by the power of your Holy Spirit to be responsible trustees of the gospel. Help us to be good stewards of all the things that you have given us and bring us into the joy of your eternal kingdom. through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And friends, now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom be glory forever and forever. And the people said,
Amen.
Go in peace, friends.